Good morning, viewers. Today, we will talk about nuclear test and its environmental fallouts as a part of international relations subject. Weapons and war, they go together and they are complementary. The Second World War or the two world wars of the 20th century have developed weapons of mass destruction of chemical and biological variety, which in a way wiped off the distinction between the combatants and the non-combatants, and we call them as weapons of mass destruction. Then came the nuclear weapon, the thermonuclear weapon to be very specific, and then with the invention by the end of the World War II, nuclear weapons started coming in, and then the age of nuclear weapons started, and this is a new invention in weapons of mass destruction. In 1945, the Manhattan test, which is called the Trinity explosion, marked the first successful detonation of a nuclear device on 16th July 1945. The Americans were competing with the Germans so that they first capture the nuclear technology and go with the bomb. Nuclear explosions are many times lethal than conventional explosions. The conventional explosion also gives you heat, shock waves, so on and so forth, but then the explosion of this nucleus causes skin burns, starts fire and considerable distance, and then the nuclear explosions are also accompanied by various forms of radiation lasting for few days to few years. Here we should know something about the radioactive material. Radioactive material, which is also called fissile material, has a tendency to develop into isotopes and then takes longer time to decompose. This decomposition of this fissile material is called the half-life period, and there are half-life periods ranging from days to years on. You could see in this graphic what kind of weaponry is there. You have kilotons and megatons, is the explosive quality is measured in these kilotons and megatons, and kilotons means a nuclear weapon which produces 1000 tons of TNT, and then a nuclear weapon of a megaton quality is million kilos of TNT. And then the energy release is so mammoth, you could see the devastation, and as Oppenheimer was telling in the very first test, that it is a cosmic kind of devastation. You have two kinds, or to be very specific, three, four varieties of nuclear weapons. First is called the fission variety, and the other is called the fusion variety of weapons. The very first weapon, which was dropped on Japan, on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the weapons were fission variety weapons. And then came in 1950s, where in this fission weapons, plutonium and enriched uranium used to be used. In fission fusion technology, you use deuterium, and which is a hydrogen isotope, so you call it as hydrogen bomb, and it is more lethal than the fission material. So the bomb yield is in to megatons. So then came the neutron bombs, which are referred as enhanced radiation weapons, which is small thermonuclear weapons and all that. And let me tell you here, each of this requires some sort of a nuclear test to be done before upgrading it into weapon grade thing. Nuclear chain and the various steps needed to process uranium are referred as the nuclear fuel cycle, nothing to do with any recycling of the energy, beginning with the natural resources of uranium and ending to the nuclear waste. This chain keeps going on and then creates debris of fissile material, and then you can even prepare the fuel rods, make plutonium, and ending in nuclear waste and fallout from nuclear explosion and damages. It damages the environment very badly and the human health irreparably. Millions of people are suffered around the world from the effects of this civilian and military nuclear industry. There is radioactive fallout. You could see number of much fissile material which has a various kinds of half-life period in this table. You could see that. You could see americium, you could see cadmium, various kinds of isotopes with various half-life periods getting emitted. And here one has to keep in mind, sometimes the half-life period runs into hundreds of years. That means the debris which is created because of the nuclear test to decompose takes hundreds of years, emitting nuclear radiation continuously and affecting the flora, fauna, aquifer, environment altogether. One example is how people take exposed to the radioactive fallout. People can be exposed to the radioactive fallout on the outside of the body, which is called the external kind of fallout, and then inside the body, such as special organs, internal, and the total quantity of radiation as a person is exposed to it is called doses. Exposure to the radioactive material from the fallout may occur in several ways. From the direct skin contact of the fallout, practice in the air, particles in the air, the fallout particles that fell on the ground, and from the eating plants, milk, meat that had radioactive fallout on it, which is internal, from breathing the radioactive material in the air, which is internal. So, the material which is unleashed does not go anywhere, it in a way exists there in the biological cycles and externally and internally affects the people who are around. Here is an example of how a radioactive iodine, how does it affect human health. It is called iodine-131, the general iodine which is used for medical purposes. When it becomes an isotope, becomes very lethal and dangerous, and then it goes into atmosphere, it goes into plants, it goes into animals, and it goes into milk, and then it comes into your body, and you have number of problems related to thyroid and other kinds of problems which occur, and probably various kinds of carcinogenic effects come because of consumption of this radioactive iodine. The effects of net effect of these nuclear tests have been carried out more than 60 locations around the globe. Now, the number is more than that, it is around 70 locations around the globe, often on the lands where the indigenous minority people far away from habitations and all that dwell, and the people working on these programs, and then down the wind, and then downstream communities, and all these communities get affected. There is an organization which looks into the lethalness of what exactly happens. The International Physicians for Prevention of Nuclear War has estimated that roughly 2.4 million people tested, 2.4 million people will eventually die as a result of the atmospheric nuclear test conducted between 1945 and 1980. This is up to 1980, which is at the fag end of the Cold War, which were equal to the in force to 29,000 of Hiroshima bombs. The effect of the nuclear weapon tests. Nuclear weapons detonations have extreme and long lasting environmental consequences, including disruptions of the earth's climate and agriculture productivity. A limited regional nuclear conflict involving only 100 Hiroshima size nuclear weapons would severely disrupt the global climate and agriculture for 2 decades, which is called nuclear winter may come in, and then nuclear famine also may come in. Since 1945, more than 2000 nuclear explosive tests have been carried out around the globe. You could see the big list: United States of America, the erstwhile USSR leading the chart, and then France coming the next in 2010, and United Kingdom with 45, China coming with another 45, India coming with 6 in 1974 and 78, Pakistan coming with other tests. So, North Korea is coming up with its own tests, and this is how from 1945 to 2009 you have precisely 2083 nuclear tests across 70 places in the globe. You could see in this graphic how number of nuclear explosions till 2013 took place, where the red and the orange will show you the story of how and the blue will show you the story of US, Russia and the other countries, how they went on and on. Here, let us see the top 5 famous test sites and what happened to the people around. The Bikini Atoll, first peacetime detonation of a nuclear bomb happened on the Bikini Atoll in the Marshall Islands, it is in the Pacific Ocean, in 1946. In total, more than 20 tests were carried out on the atoll. A huge hydrogen bomb codenamed Casual Bravo was also detonated in 1954. Spread of the radioactive fallout over more than 11,000 square kilometers contaminated several inhabitants in the island, including Rogrix, Rongleip and Utrik, as well as the Japanese fish vessels. Many islanders and the Japanese crew suffered acute radiation sickness from external radiation. Inhabitants of contaminated islands were evacuated a few days after Casual Bravo, but long-term studies show increased levels of cancer, especially of thyroid, most likely to the internal radiation with iodine-131 occurring in these areas. Then the second thing, Novaya Zemalya, this is a remote island in Arctic Circle. The site is the world's biggest nuclear detonation, the Tsar bomb, which is a hydrogen bomb which causes 100 megatons of explosion in 1961 is tested. The last test at Novaya Zemalya took place in 1991. Scientists expedition found increased level of selenium, cesium-137, stranetium-90, cobalt-60 and plutonium-239 and 241 in sediments close to the fossards, which were used as radioactive waste dumps in 1992. A Russian study found that 67% to 72% of the all underground tests radioactive gases had leaked through the rock formations. The indigenous population in the region around Novaya Zemalya received even higher radiation doses. Most notably affected radiation exposure were the semi-nomadic Sami people of the Arctic region, the former inhabitants of Novaya Zemalya. The Kirmiti and Malden Islands at Kirmiti, a total 33 nuclear detonations were conducted, 2 atolls of the Republic of Kirmiti by the United Kingdom and then United States in 1950 and 1960. Thousands of islanders and servicemen were subjected to radioactive fallout and now suffer from radioactive effects. In 2006, 300 former people of Christmas Island residents submitted a petition to the European Parliament accusing UK for knowingly exposing them to the radioactive fallout despite knowing that the dangers. Today, many suffer from long-term effects of the radiation exposure. Semipalatinsk is another case, which is Russia's first nuclear device was detonated here in 1949. It began a process of including 456 nuclear explosions. Semipalatinsk is actually in Kazakhstan, and after the collapse of the Soviet Union, the site was returned to the Kazakhs. Here one has to notice that much of the tests which have done at this place are overground tests and no protection was offered to any people. There is a widespread agreement that the local population has suffered greatly. Several thousands of square kilometers of land remains contaminated for generations to come. No one knows for sure about conditions of the water supplies and soil throughout the region. Local officials say that hundreds and thousands of people from the region, possibly as many as 1.5 million, were affected by this Russian nuclear test site. This is the fifth one, the Nevada test sites in America. Nevada test site is located about 105 kilometers northwest to Las Vegas, was the largest and most important nuclear weapons test site in US from 1951 until 1992. The total of 1021 nuclear tests were conducted on the 3500 square kilometers site. 100 above these tests released estimated 222,000 petabecquerels or peta quadrillions of radioactive material into the atmosphere. According to the National Cancer Institute of United States, population was exposed to the total dose of 4,000 persons sievets of iodine-131 through this nuclear weapon test in Nevada, about 500 times the total radiation dose of Chernobyl, 7,300 PSV. A study published in 1999 estimated that the expected cases of thyroid cancer due to the Nevada nuclear weapon tests amount about 10,000 to 75,000. In 2006, it was found that 1,800 radiations related to leukemia deaths could be expected in the US as a result of the Nevada nuclear weapon tests. Despite these alarming findings, no routine thyroid cancer screenings are undertaken in the affected regions. This is one example of how the nuclear test fallout leads to environmental disaster. Friends, one has to keep in mind, we are not talking about use of the nuclear weapon here, we are just talking about what happens to the environment nearby where the test sites are there. Then probably you can imagine what happens when such a weapon is really used. The human and environmental devastation caused by decades of nuclear testing is still to be felt today. More than 60 years after detonation of the Casual Bravo bomb, the island is still too dangerous to live in. In June 2016, researchers from Columbia University reports the levels as high as 631 millirems per year, an average of 184 millirems of radioactivity is there. The researchers compared those readings with levels of New York Central Park, which shows just 9 millirems. The remote areas, the remote atolls, the remote places, probably the locations of indigenous people and all that can be pumped with so much of radioactivity. That's what it is. Let's look into the stockpiles. This is another big problem, because if one is the testing is the big problem, the second problem is stockpiling, because each of the stockpile gets retired over a period of time. Upwards 128,000 nuclear weapons have been produced in the past 60 odd years, which about 98% produced in United States and former Soviet Union. The 9 current members of the nuclear club, United States, Russia, Great Britain, France, India, Pakistan, China, Israel and North Korea, still possess about 27,000 operational nuclear weapons between them. The problem here is, when you don't use these weapons, there is a high possibility of the weapons retirement, and then these weapons have to be decommissioned, and that decommission also leads to serious radiation problems. At least another 15 countries currently have on hand enough highly enriched uranium as for the nuclear weapons. This graphic will tell you the story. Nuclear weapons from 1945 to 2015, how this nuclear weapon started growing and growing. We have our own cup of tea, Pokhran 1, which is called the Smiling Buddha. On 18th May 1974, we did our test, saying that India's first underground nuclear test, showing to the world that we are capable. Then we went for Pokhran test, which called as Operation Shakti. When India became nuclear, the Pokhran 2, we detonated 15 kiloton, 45 kiloton and 0.25 kiloton 3 bombs there. And probably, we are not speaking about what exactly is the fallout of these two nuclear weapon tests on the surroundings. Probably, we have to wait for some decommissioning of the files, and maybe the top secret security may never come out. Keeping this situation in view, nuclear weapon free zones are mooted by Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty of 1970. This nuclear weapon free zones, or those zones, came into place from 1967 onwards. In 1967, you have Treaty of Tlatelolco, where the entire Latin America said it will become a nuclear free zone. Then in 1985, the Treaty of Rarotonga made the entire South Pacific nuclear free zone. In 1995, the Treaty of Bangkok made Southeast Asia a nuclear weapon free zone. In 1996, the Treaty of Pelindaba made Africa a nuclear free zone, and in 2006, Semipalatinsk Treaty made the Central Asia nuclear free zone. But there is a problem with this, because the nuclear free zone covenant or agreement which comes in must be agreed by the existing nuclear powers. That means, existing nuclear powers must accept that the outer space, land, waters of these nuclear weapon zones must not be used by these countries in any way. It is a long way to go, but nuclear weapon free zones are showing some sort of way out. International Physicians for Prevention of Nuclear War is an organization which is highlighting the net effects of nuclear tests, nuclear radiation. In 1985, got a Nobel Peace Prize, and here are various websites, books and papers for your perusal to know more about the fallout of nuclear tests. Thank you very much.